Good morning. Good morning, Shady Grove. If you would grab your worship folders, we have just a few announcements that I want to go over. Number one, you will see in your worship folder a blue insert that says Favorite Hymns. And it says, for the summer months of July and August, we're singing your favorite hymns. Please list your five favorite hymns below, then place them in the offering basket at the entrance to the worship center on your way out. So, if I see you looking through your hymnal while I'm preaching, that's okay. I'll pretend it's your Bible. But look through the hymnal. If you know your hymn, if you know the name of it, just write it down. If you know the hymn number, you can put that down too. But write your five favorite hymns, put this in one of the offering baskets at the back on your way out, and for the next couple of months, we will sing your favorite hymns. Right? Now, it doesn't mean we're going to sing all the hymns that you turn in. If it's some obscure hymn that's in Latin, we're probably not going to sing that. Unless Clay knows Latin. Just well enough to write prescriptions or something like that. Okay. Anyway, so do that, and then next week, July 4th, that's next week, right? Okay, next week, July 4th, we will have our Independence Day celebration, so immediately after worship service, we will go into Fellowship Hall, because I know you like freedom, and you like food, right? And on holidays, food has no extra calories. It's actually good for you so chili cheese dogs, hamburgers, whatever. It's good for you. So, immediately after worship, we will go back into Fellowship Hall and we'll have a good time eating. And we're going to have a little patriotic type celebration, sing some of our patriotic hymns out of the hymnal, that kind of stuff. So, be here for that. And I'm going to have Chris come real quick and give an announcement. I'm going to make you use this microphone right over here.
Is it on?
It is.
Good morning, Shady Grove. Hey, we're looking for people, the nominating committee, for people to serve on committees, especially a couple of the ones, I can't think of what it's called now. No, not missions, the hospitality committees and those kind of things. So, I've talked to these kids and tried to get them to do it. So if anybody wants to serve on one, talk to me or Norma Moses. Thank you.
All right. Serving on a committee gets you prepared for heaven because you know there's committees in heaven, right? No. There's committees in the other place. By the other place, I mean New Jersey. Anyway, real quick, starting today, well, actually starting next week, we are beginning a five-part, I'm going to call it five-part because it sounds shorter, sermon series, new message series on five spiritual disciplines. This will last 5 months. Each spiritual discipline we're going to cover will go for 1 month, so I encourage you to be here for that. And one more thing, if you didn't know, on this wall over here, in that what was formerly a window and is now our gospel net display. If you don't remember or have never heard what gospel net is, it's Gospel Northeast Tarrant. This is a visual representation of our fulfilling the Great Commission. On the far basket on the left are blue ping pong balls. Those are to be taken. Anytime you invite someone to church, take a blue ping pong ball, put it in that basket. Anytime you have a gospel conversation with someone, oh, hold on. Hey, Jeanette, that's not turned on, the top box? Okay. Anytime you have a gospel conversation with someone, meaning you share the gospel with them, you take a green ping pong ball and put it behind the plexiglass plate there. And anytime someone is led to Christ, someone comes to know Jesus as their Savior, we take a white ping pong ball. Guys, I have four white ping pong balls. So, Joshua, Did you get saved? Joshua got saved, guys. So, we had one little boy saved during VBS. Joshua was like right at the end of VBS, I think, somewhere in that time frame. And then this week I was able to lead a young couple to Christ Thursday night. And so we have four balls this week that are going in that. And this is in 1 month, guys. Oops. 1 month at Shady Grove, God has blessed us with four salvations. I believe he's doing something here, guys. And I hope you want to be a part of this. So, sometime later, I'll put these in the basket over there. So right now, Clay is going to come and lead us in worship.
All right, nothing gets us more in tune to sing hymns of the faith like hearing about four people who've come to faith, right? So let's take that spiritual energy and let's sing to our Lord here this morning as we get our hearts ready to worship. Stand with me if you would. We're going to sing hymn 83, There's Something About That Name.
Pray with me. Father God, we are so grateful that we can come and worship you. We know that there is no other name under heaven whereby we must be saved. And there's something about that name. God, this morning we celebrate because four names have been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Four souls have been saved. Four people have entered into a relationship with you. Because of the precious name of Jesus. Father, may this spark a revival in our hearts, a revival in this church, knowing that you are not done here, that you have a purpose and a plan for us. God, I pray for your Holy Spirit move in this church today. Touch our hearts. Help us to draw closer to you, deeper into that relationship. God, start something here. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, grab your hymnals and turn to hymn 43. We are going to sing All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. This is a big anthem hymn, y'all. Sing it loud. Take that spiritual energy that you just felt as we did our call to worship. Use that and sing hard here. Sing hymn 43 with me.
I want to ask our kids to come on up here. Whoa. Okay, I need y'all to stand up. I need y'all to stand right here. Follow in line behind me. Are y'all behind me? Okay, get in line behind me. Y'all follow me and do what I do, okay? Can y'all follow me and do what I do? Okay, ready? Are they doing it? She's trying. You're doing a good job, Fatima. Okay. Yeah, y'all sit down. Y'all are being silly.
I'm not really used to getting all the way down by myself.
Well, you did a fantastic job, Fatima. Okay. Hey, guys. I ask you to follow me and do what I do, right? Which is kind of weird stuff, flapping my arms and stuff. But, hey, I was trying to keep it simple. You know, because I'm old and I might fall and hurt myself. Jesus, in two different passages we're going to look at today briefly, one in Matthew chapter 4, verse 19, he sees some of his disciples, before they were his disciples, standing at the seaside, mending nets and doing what fishermen do because they were fishermen. And he said, hey, follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. But then you go to the book of Mark chapter 2, I think it's verse 19. He says, maybe it's 14. He says to his to this guy, Matthew, or Levi was his name at the time, who was a tax collector. He collected taxes, worked for the IRS. And he said, follow me. So to the first guys, what did he say? He said, follow me. That's right. He said, follow me. And to the second guy, he said, Follow me. You guys are paying attention. So Jesus calls us to be his disciples and to follow him. And following him doesn't just mean like walking in circles, doing what he does, but what it means is to follow him and learn from him, do what he does. He was teaching the disciples how to pray. He was teaching them how to be in God's word, how to live a life devoted to God. And as his disciples, look, if you're saved, you should be a disciple of Jesus. You should follow him and learn to do what he wants you to do. That's what it means to follow him. So guys, listen, when you become a Christian, it means following Jesus. How do you know how to follow him? He gives us his word. He says, look in here, and I'll show you how to follow me. So guys, I want y'all to be followers of Jesus your whole lives, okay? All right, y'all go sit down.
Sit on. Hello? Would you stand with me for a scripture reading? This is 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 through 10. But have nothing to do with pointless and silly myths. Rather, train yourself in godliness, for the training of the body has limited benefits. But godliness is beneficial in every way, since it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. This saying is trustworthy and deserves full acceptance. For this reason we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially of those who believe. This is the word of God.
Amen. All right, grab those hymnals. Let's join together singing hymn 762, What a Day That Will Be. Ready for our prayer time and for our message this morning, 6:54. Change my heart, O God. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the
As we come to our prayer time, it's a simply time where we go before our Father and we seek His face and we take our prayers, our petitions, our needs to Him. And I pray that you would go to Him for the person that's next to you, on your left, your right, in front of you, behind you, and lift their name to our Father, their needs. You might not even know their needs, but they have needs. So lift them to Him this morning. So let's go to the Father, seek His face, and ask for His blessing. Father God, as we approach your throne, we do so with humbled hearts, recognizing your majesty, your sovereignty, your goodness to us. God, we're so thankful for the salvation that you provided on Calvary, that Jesus gave his life to save us and to help us enter in relationship with you, be reconciled, reunited. God, every day, help us to think about that salvation, that sacrifice, live a life of gratitude. God, as we have family here today who desperately need your hand in their lives, emotionally, spiritually, physically, we lift them to you, believing that you'll answer our prayers, that your spirit would touch their bodies, their minds, their souls, and make them better, whole. Those who are not here because they're sick, they're in the hospital, at home, we pray for healing for them, for your strength, your comfort in their lives, for those loved ones who are caring for them, for strength, believing that your hand will be on them. God, for those souls that have been saved, we're so grateful. And help us to see other lives changed, to be empowered, emboldened to share your gospel, to tell anyone, someone about Christ and his saving power. And God, as we begin this series through the spiritual disciplines, we ask that you would draw us closer, deeper into fellowship and communion with you. Father, bless us now. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
I could do it a cappella.
Kind of homesick for that.
Well, this morning, we're starting a five-part sermon series called Five Spiritual Disciplines. And as I said, it's actually 5 months long, so it's five spiritual disciplines. Each one will be approximately 4 weeks. Some of the months have an extra week or here or there. But anyway, let me briefly discuss how we came upon this sermon series. And today's sermon is not my typical 3 points, 4 points, expository type. Not even really it's a topical of sorts, but it's going to be a little bit different. It's me basically talking to you about what we're doing over the next 5 months and why. As many of you, some of you know, about twice a year, I go away on what I call a mini sabbatical, and it's usually a weekend where I go to a cabin in the woods, camping, hotel, Riverbend Retreat Center. I go somewhere and I get alone with God for 2 or 3 days, and I just get all distractions out of my brain, out of my heart, out of my this way, and I just spend time. I pray and I read scripture. I might take a book and read and go to church somewhere and just allow God to clear this out and talk to me. And my goal and my desire is that He just gives me a renewed energy, that He gives me a purpose, a direction for our church, for my life, for our ministry. And so I went to, on Memorial Day weekend, I went to the spiritual mecca of Texas, Jacksboro. Is that funny? Have you ever been to Jacksboro? Yeah, it was funny. There's only one thing in Jacksboro. There's a state park. It's a pretty nice state park. But when you stand in the middle of a state park and look left and can see town, it's weird. So I went to Jacksboro because it's Memorial Day weekend and every state park in Texas was full and everywhere else was full, and I'm not really big on planning ahead. So I go to Jacksboro and I get there on Saturday and I check into this hotel and I begin praying and I'm reading scripture and I had a book with me. I'm reading through my book, and some of you would love the name of this book. Have you ever read The Gospel According to Starbucks? Leonard Sweet. Are you familiar with Leonard Sweet? Okay, it's The Gospel According to Starbucks. Leonard Sweet, not Nimoy. Okay. And so I'm reading and I'm studying, and Saturday all day I'm waiting for God to speak to me, and it's nothing. And I think that really what God was doing on Saturday is just wanting me to empty myself of me and everything, and just so He could fill me. And Sunday I get up and I go to First Baptist Jacksboro, which is a lovely church, beautiful building, really nice people. Pastor had an excellent message, really friendly guy. If you ever go to Jacksboro, I'll recommend First Baptist, great church. And they had donuts and coffee, which was awesome. And I'm sitting somewhere where good Baptists sit, in the back, sorry. And I have my notebook out and my Bible, and the pastor begins to preach. And really early in his message, I felt God, it's almost like He just gave me these words. I didn't hear them audibly. I don't think the pastor said them, but it was spiritual disciplines. And in the 20-whatever years of ministry that I've been in, I've never taught on, preached on, spoken of spiritual disciplines. Now, the five spiritual disciplines we're talking about over the next 5 months, I have taught on almost all of these at some point or another, or extensively many times, but never as spiritual disciplines. And so I really felt God wanted me to go this direction, and so I started just jotting notes, writing in my notebook and all kinds of stuff, and flipping through my Bible, looking at scriptures and trying to figure out what are the spiritual disciplines. And after the sermon, after the service, I snuck out a side door, as any typical good visitor would do, right? And I sneak out and I go and get some more inspiration at a local Mexican restaurant. And after lunch, I go back to the hotel and I have my notebook, and there's a, you know, the hotels have a little desk. I'm sitting there and I'm just writing and I'm Googling things and I'm trying to figure out, well, how many spiritual disciplines are there? Well, it depends on who you ask. And so I found some guys are like, man, there's like 25 spiritual disciplines. I'm like, well, my people aren't going to sit still for that. We'd be here for a while. That's a couple of years, right? And so some guys are like, there's 25 spiritual disciplines, there's 18 spiritual disciplines, and everyone has their idea of how many spiritual disciplines there are. Because honestly, if you look in Scripture, nowhere does Jesus sit down and say, hey, look, guys, disciples, I want you to learn these spiritual disciplines. This is what, and here they are. He doesn't hand them an outline saying these 5, 6, 10, whatever spiritual disciplines are what you need to learn from me. He doesn't do that. Paul doesn't do that. Nowhere in the New Testament do they sit down and say, look, there's spiritual disciplines, you need to learn these as a believer. Or why? Well, after some studying and praying, I believe that God gave me these 5 spiritual disciplines I want us to cover over the next few months. And this is not to say these are the only spiritual disciplines. It's just these are 5 that I believe we as Shady Grove, or I believe God thinks we as Shady Grove need to deal with. Now, some of them might be like, next month we're studying prayer and fasting, but I don't think you can separate prayer and fasting. In my opinion, they go hand in hand. You can't separate them. So we're going to study prayer and fasting next week. Well, that's not to say that all these lists that I saw are wrong or incomplete or complete, whatever, because some of them had things on there that are simply not biblical, what I would consider biblical spiritual disciplines. So I want us to cover biblical spiritual disciplines, because honestly, if you journal, that's great. Journaling is a wonderful discipline, but I don't think it's a biblical discipline because it's just not in there. But if you journal, hey, that's amazing. It works for a lot of people. Do it. So we're going to cover these 5 things, and we'll talk about those in a second. So here's our definition of spiritual discipline. Spiritual disciplines are those biblical practices that lead you closer to God. That's it. I mean, you can Google the definition of spiritual discipline. You're going to find a bunch of guys a lot smarter than me that have these really good definitions. But this is what I came up with. The spiritual disciplines are those biblical practices that lead you closer to God. So here's our purpose of spiritual disciplines. Jeanette, change the slide. Spiritual disciplines are not practiced to make you a better person. Look, Jesus was surrounded by guys who, for all intents and purposes, were not bad people. A lot of the Pharisees, we think Pharisee, we think Sadducee, we think, oh, bad person. Not all of them were. You going to tell me Nicodemus was a bad guy? No. Some of the Pharisees, the people that came to Jesus, the religious leaders, were good guys. They were good people. The spiritual disciplines are not to make us better people. Spiritual disciplines are practiced to draw us closer to God. Go to the next one, Jeanette. Oh, there it is there. Spiritual disciplines are practiced to draw you closer to a better person, closer to God. That's it. The spiritual disciplines draw us closer to our Heavenly Father. That's it. Look, I was telling the kids this morning in Matthew chapter 4, verse 19, Jesus sees the disciples there. They're by the seashore, mending nets, doing their thing. And these guys are fishermen. And Jesus walks up and he says, hey, follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. He's saying something that speaks to them, right? Fishers of men. They're fishermen. That's what they do. So they would understand when Jesus said, well, they probably didn't completely understand when he said fishers of men. They're like, okay, let's go. So they follow Jesus. Later on in Mark chapter 2, Jesus is walking along and he sees Matthew. He just let this big crowd. There's a big crowd there. He leaves them, probably this big entourage, this big crowd still following him. He sees Levi sitting at his tax collector table. He's at work, and Jesus sees him there, and he says, follow me. Now, if he had gone up to Matthew, Levi, and said, follow me, I'll make you a fisher of men, Levi would have been like, I'm good. Yeah, I got a nice desk job, making pretty good money. Why do I want to be a fisherman? No, that's all right. But Jesus didn't say that. He said, follow me. And so Levi, Matthew, gets up and he follows Jesus. In the next passage, as we see, he throws this big party for Jesus, right? With all the sinners and heathens there. It was rock on. So what Jesus is telling these men is, I want you to follow me and become what I teach you to become. He's saying, I'm going to teach you things. Now, he doesn't just come out and say, I want to teach you this, 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 and this. But when you go into like the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus absolutely is teaching them to pray and to fast and to give, how to treat people, how to forgive. He's saying there are these certain spiritual disciplines, without saying this, that you need to learn to draw you closer to the Father. When Jesus calls us as his disciples, as believers, he wants to teach us these spiritual disciplines. Why? To draw us closer to God. That's it. It's not to make you a better person, not to make you a super Christian. That's not it. That's not the point. Those things happen when you draw closer to God. As you grow closer to him, you naturally are conformed into the image of Christ. It just happens that way. And I believe that's the way God designed it to be. So look, in John chapter 14, verses 6 through 11, Jesus is having this little coffee shop talk, sitting around the campfire top talk with his disciples, and they're going deep here, right? And I love when Jesus did this, when it was just him and the disciples, like the 12 or so, and they get into some deep stuff. And Jesus is like, you know, saying stuff, and they're like mind blown, you know? And so this is one of those times where they have this good discussion in John chapter 14. And we're going to read verses 6 through 11. Jesus told him, he's talking to Thomas, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will also know my Father. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Lord, said Philip, show us the Father, and that's enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been among you all this time without your knowing me, Philip? The one who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words I speak to you, I do not speak on my own. The Father who lives in me does his works. Believe me that I am the Father and the Father is in me. Stop right there. So look, Jesus came for this reason, to bring us into relationship with the Father. Because of sin, we are separated from God. We all know that. Everyone here who has accepted Christ, who is a saved, born-again believer, knows that we have sin in our lives, and that sin separates us from God. Jesus came to conquer that sin, to reunite us in that relationship, to make it right. Jesus is saying right here, look, I came to so that you can have a relationship with the Father. You have a relationship with the Father through having this relationship with me. You look at me, you see me, you see God. And they're probably sitting back thinking, okay, all right. Eventually, these guys learn, right? They finally understand. One day there's this, boom, epiphany. You know, the Holy Spirit says, hey, dummy. And they're like, oh, he was God. He is God. We do see Father through him. So listen, Jesus came so that we can have a relationship, so that we can know the Father. There it is right there. So we can know him personally. It's not so we can pray through a saint, pray through somebody else, that somebody can pray for us. It's so that we can go directly to the Father. Jesus says, if you know me, you know the Father. How many of y'all know Jesus? Okay, Clay put his hand up. All right, we got one saved. We're having a big invitation here today. How many of y'all know Jesus? Thank you. Okay. So some of y'all sit and raise your hands, mostly my deacons. I'm kidding. So if you know Jesus, you know the Father, right? So Jesus came so we could have this relationship with the Father, so we can know him personally, but so we can also know him intimately. You think about times like this, when Jesus and these disciples are just sitting around having this heart-to-heart, and God wants to have that intimate relationship with you. He's not some cosmic, mystic being up in outer space playing chess with us. He's a God whose Holy Spirit takes residence in us so he can have that intimate relationship with us. And finally, he wants to be passionate. You think these 12 guys right here, these 12 he's talking to in John chapter 14, you don't think they're passionate? You've got to be passionate to do what they did, to leave everything they have, everything, family, possessions, jobs, everything. I mean, they gave up their Social Security. their retirement, right? Their 401k. They left everything to go all over the world. And do you know how many of these guys gave their life, meaning they died sharing the gospel? Do you know? Every single one. Now, John was on the Isle of Patmos, supposedly died when he was old, but he was died in exile, right? These guys gave their life, their very life. We're willing to die. That's passionate. That's passionate. How passionate are you for Christ? How passionate is your relationship with the Father? I'm telling you. He came so we can know him personally, intimately, passionately. Jesus wants us to have that relationship with the Father. As we study these disciplines, that's our goal, so that we can draw closer to him. That's it. I mean, it's not that... I don't think a pastor is supposed to say my sermon's not that profound, but it's really not. It's that simple, that we are to draw closer to God. Listen, I'm kind of on this love languages kick. Y'all know the book, Gary Chapman wrote this book. I think I've talked about that recently, either in Sunday school or in here, and probably both. And this love languages book, he says there's these five love languages. And these love languages are how you speak your love to other people and how you receive love. And do I have them up there? Do you have? I don't think I put them up there. Nope, that's not them. Go back one. Oh, there you go. We don't want to get ahead. Here's his love languages. In his book, he says there's five love languages. Words of affirmation. That's where you love to hear praise, right? You love to people to say nice, wonderful things. Oh, you look nice in that dress today. Oh, I love when you pick up your socks off the floor and I don't have to pick them up for you, right? Words of affirmation. And then there's acts of service, where you do something for someone. Like if my kids would get up and mow the yard for me, that would speak so much to me, right? Anyway, acts of service. Physical touch. Physical touch is one of my spiritual, or my love languages, because I love touching my wife. Just, she can tell you, if I'm within arm's reach, I touch her, right? At the house, bump into her on purpose all the time. It's not because I'm old and clumsy. She can tell you, if she's within arm's reach, whether it's at the store, at church, or somewhere, I don't know if you ever notice, if I go in the back of the sound booth, I'll give her a kiss. You know, it's just the way I'm addicted to her. Anyway, my kids, I love on my kids all the time. So physical touch, gifts. Jeanette and Jake, one of their love languages is gifts. They love giving gifts. Jake works at Whataburger. Can I get an amen? Right? And he brings strawberry milkshakes home to his mom almost every night that he works. Isn't that sweet? He just likes to do things for his mom. He bought her a gift recently because he could, because he's just, that's the way he loves her. And Jeanette loves to give gifts. And so that's how they show their love. And then finally, quality time, where you spend quality time with somebody, right? So these are Gary Chapman's five love languages. And so what it is when you go through this book, through counseling or whatever, you're learning to, like, say you're in couples counseling, and you learn what your love language is, you learn what your spouse or your significant other's love language is, and how to speak their love language. If theirs is gifts, you learn that they receive love by you giving them gifts. And you need to learn their love language so you can speak it to them and make them feel loved. That makes sense? And they learn to speak yours. Now, I want you to don't mishear me here, all right? I want you to think of these five disciplines as God's love languages. I'm not saying they are, okay? I'm not saying they're his love languages. I want you to look at them as if they are. Totally different. If I said they were, that would probably be heresy or something. But look at them as if they're God's love languages, and it's saying, God, this is how you love me and how I can love you. Because when you learn these disciplines and you practice these disciplines, it's you drawing closer to him and him saying, yeah, I like worship. It's God saying, I love when you give. Why? Because God, who gave the greatest gift the world has ever known? Thank you very much. God knows how to give good gifts. I mean, we look at these five spiritual disciplines, and it's a way that we can express our love to God, and he can express his love to us. When you worship, and the Holy Spirit just comes over you, I'm telling you, If you've never experienced it, your wood's wet. You know what I'm saying? The Holy Spirit just gets over you when you're worshiping, and he takes over, and you're praising God, and God's like, I love you so much. Listen. Five spiritual disciplines. You got those up there? Prayer, scripture, worship, giving, and evangelism. Listen, in the month of July, we're going to talk about prayer. For 3 weeks, we're going to talk about prayer. What is prayer? How do we pray? That kind of stuff. The last week, we're going to talk about fasting and how fasting is seriously something that so many Christians don't do, but we should. There's so much power in fasting. It just, I'm telling you, it will humble you. It will draw you to Christ. And then in August, we're going to talk about scripture. And in scripture, we're going to talk about why scripture is important, how we study scripture, why we memorize scripture, how utterly important scripture is in our lives. And then worship. Oh, by the end of September, we're going to be some Pentecostals up in here. All right. Well, Clay, you ready? Okay, Clay's ready. Y'all heard it. Man, we're going to be raising some holy hands, Baptists, right here. No, Dottie, stop it. Baptists are down here. She grew up Methodist. Methodists are down here. All right. So we'll be holy rolling up in here. So by the end of it, man, we're going to learn to worship. Let me tell you real quick. Let me give you some words of affirmation. When my wife and family, when we were moving late last year, we took a couple of Sundays off to move, and we visited a local contemporary church. Wonderful church, beautiful people, incredible service, loved it a lot. But as they were doing the worship, and these were all songs I knew that I hear on the radio, it's almost as if nobody was singing. And then the Saturday before the once-in-a-lifetime ice storm hit back in February, because we knew we weren't going to be here on Sunday because ice was coming, and it's Texas, and we don't do ice, except in our Sonic Dr. Pepper. That's some good ice right there, right? We visited another local church, a fairly large church. They have Saturday services. So we're like, hey, you know, let's go sit in church on Saturday, see what this place is all about. We get there, and the praise worship team, the band were great. Knew all the songs, most of them anyway. But yet, it's like the congregation was like, you hear a cricket out there. And then I come here and I hear you sing. You guys would blow them away. I tell you what, I love to hear this. I love being right in here, feeling your, I was going to say your breath, but that's gross. Feeling you, and we're social distancing, so I shouldn't be able to feel your breath. But to feel you worship, it's incredible. I love to sing these old hymns of the faith. Anyway. So we're going to talk about worship. We're going to talk about giving. We're going to talk about what is a tithe, what is biblical giving for a whole month. I know some of you are like, I ain't coming that month. Yes, you are. You're going to be here, and you're going to enjoy it, and God's going to speak to you. It's going to be incredible. And then in November, we're going to talk about evangelism and missions. And my friend Bo, he goes, I can't wait till you preach at your church at evangelism, telling people about Jesus as a spiritual discipline. Have you ever led someone to Christ? I don't know that there's a time you're closer to Christ than when you're leading someone to him and they're praying sinner's prayer. I get emotional. I tell you what, it's incredible. Okay, so we're going to talk about these five spiritual disciplines and how practicing these things draws you closer to the Father. And man, isn't that what it's all about, that relationship with him? But I want you to see this. First things first. In order to practice these spiritual disciplines and draw closer to God, you must be saved. If you are here today and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, everything we do over the next 5 months is just going to be a good pep talk. Because you won't be any closer to God than the day we started. You need Christ as your Savior. So I know almost all y'all, and I know almost all y'all have a relationship with Christ. Some of you have a question. I'm kidding. But you need to have accepted Christ as your Savior, and here's how you do it. A, admit that you're a sinner. you know you sin, right? When I tell little kids, I say, hey, you know what a sinner is? They're like, my brother, right? The sin is when you do anything wrong. It's that thing that you know is wrong. A little white lie, man. Admit you're a sinner, because God, the gospel of the scripture says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It separates us from God. Number two, believe the gospel, right? Believe that Jesus died on the cross and rose again the third day. Romans chapter 10. You believe the gospel. Number three, confess. Confess to him. Say, God, I am sorry for my sins, and I confess that Jesus is Lord. And then you pray and say, God, save me. So if you've never done that, today I want you to. We're going to give an invitation at the end of the service, and I want you to say that prayer and be saved today. But it goes further. Go to the next slide. Oh, there it is. Salvation is essential, and baptism is the first step in obedience. I was talking to someone this week, a dear friend, and we were talking about people being saved and baptized, and this person has the same experience as so many other Christians, so many Baptists, is that when they were a kid, 6, 7, 8, 9 years old, they made this profession of faith because they were at kids' camp, they were at VBS, they were at revival, whatever the situation was, and the leader, the preacher, the teacher gave this invitation, said, say this prayer, raise your hand, go tell your parents, whatever it was. They said the prayer, it meant nothing, because they were saying because they were told to. And then years go by, and they realize, I really am not saved because I just recited a prayer. I really don't have that relationship with God. And so years later, they're 16, 17, 18 years old, 20, whatever years old, and they realize I'm not saved, and they make that genuine, sincere profession of faith. They ask Christ to save them. But listen, when they were a kid and made that profession, they went down, they got baptized and all that good stuff, right? But when they were older and made that profession, they didn't get baptized. Because in their mind, they're thinking, I was baptized when I was a kid. But listen, you have to have things in order. Salvation comes before baptism. I got saved when I was 18 years old, but I had been baptized when I was like 11 or 12. Maybe younger, I don't remember. Whatever, what's fifth grade? Is that like 10 or 11? 13 for me. And so I went to camp, did the whole, they prayed, you know, raised my hand, went back to my home church, they baptized me. But then when I was 18, I got saved. But I didn't get baptized because in my brain I'm thinking, well, I was baptized when I was a kid. I don't need to be baptized again. But it wasn't a biblical baptism because it was out of order. So I go off to Bible college. I'm like in my second, third year of Bible college, and a guy speaks at chapel, and he's talking about this very thing. And I'm like, holy cow, I need to be biblically baptized. So I come back to Fort Worth. Larry Cornell is my pastor. Go to Castleberry Baptist Church. I'm like, hey, I need to be baptized. And they baptize me, and they're like, what's this Bible college student doing being baptized? I'm like, I'm getting things in order. So let me ask you this morning. Do you have things in order? Has your baptism come in the proper order after you got saved? Now listen, if it hasn't, I want you to be baptized biblically, meaning after you're saved. Now if you come down to this altar during this invitation and say, Jason, I know exactly what you're talking about. I need to be baptized, biblically baptized. No one here is going to judge you. No one here is going to look down on you. Everyone here is going to be excited. They're going to clap. They're going to jump up and down. And we're going to have a revival in here. Do you understand? Everybody say yes. We're going to have a revival in here. And so you need to get things in order. You need to be saved. You need to be biblically baptized. That is so hard to say. You got to get dunked. All right? So the next thing I want you to see is this. You got to want it. As we go through this five-month series, Growing Closer to God, you have to want to draw closer to him. It's your decision. It's an act of the will. It's a decision you make that you consciously say, I want, through this series, through these teachings, to learn to practice these spiritual disciplines for the very fact of growing closer to God. I'm not worried about, am I a super Christian? I'm not worried about, am I growing as a believer? I want to grow closer to him. That's it. I don't want this to be more difficult than you think it's going to be or anything. I just want you to understand the purpose is to grow closer to God. And you make that conscious decision. Yes, I'm going to be here as often as I can. I'm going to take notes. I'm going to listen. If I miss a Sunday, it's online. I can watch it and catch up because I believe God is going to do something in the next 5 months at Shady Grove and draw this church closer to Him. And we're going to see a revival like Shady Grove's never seen. You on board with me? Amen. Let's see God do something here. In 1 month, we've had more people saved than I think in the past 4 years. 1 month. And you know what? You people have been praying and fasting and believing that God is going to do something, and God is honoring that. He's going to do something because when God's people pray and believe, God does things. Those four ping pong balls represent four lives added to His kingdom. We're not done. Let's fill up. Y'all make me buy more ping pong balls. They'll make them in China. We can get them off Amazon. Make me buy more. Let's do this. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads and close your eyes. We're going to have a brief invitation. Three things. As your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. Three things I want you to think about. Am I saved? Have I made that profession of faith in Christ? Have I bowed my head and asked God to forgive me of my sins and save me? If you haven't, today is the day of salvation. Today, call on the name of the Lord. I want you to come down. I don't want you to be ashamed or embarrassed or think somebody's going to be staring at you. You know what they're staring at you? It's because they're happy for you. If you don't know Christ, I want you to come down to this altar this morning and talk to me. And if you are that person who has things out of order, you've not been biblically baptized, things are out of order, you come down and we're going to make that right. We're going to dunk you and get you wet. It's that first step of obedience. It's identifying with Christ as He was buried and resurrected. It's an incredibly beautiful ceremony. And let me tell you, it's powerful. And the number three, are you committed? Have you made that decision, the act of the will? I want you to pray about this and say, God, I want to draw closer to You. How can I do that? Through these spiritual disciplines. God, do I need to learn to pray, to read my Bible, to worship? Is my giving not where it should be? Am I not evangelistic? Should I be? And allow God to use these disciplines in your life to draw you closer to Him, because that's what it's all about, knowing Him better. Father, this morning, as we begin this journey over these next few months, drawing closer to You, seeking Your face, God, that's it. It's that simple, God. We want to know You more, to discover who You are, to learn Your attributes, to learn to love You in a way that we haven't known, and to allow You to love us. God, may Your church commit our hearts, our lives, our souls to learning more about You, to drawing closer to You. And Father, if there's someone here who's never given their life to Jesus, I pray that You touch their hearts. Convict them this morning. Help them to understand their need for that relationship. And if there's somebody, God, in your church, your body, your family here, your children, who has things out of order, let this be the beginning of that step of obedience, that identification with Christ, identifying with Christ through death and burial and resurrection in baptism. And God, we give this invitation to You now in Jesus' name. Amen.
If you would stay seated with me and join in singing our invitation hymn, we're going to sing one verse of hymn 480, Only Trust Him.
Come every soul, thy sin oppressed, there's mercy alone, and He will surely give rest by trusting in His word. Oh,
Shady Grove, thank you for being here, for your faithfulness, and I hope, I pray that you believe that God is doing something here and that he's going to continue doing it, and that we're going to see lives change, your lives, my life, that over the next few months we're going to draw closer to him, closer than we've ever been, and we're going to see that white ping pong ball basket empty. Y'all make me buy some more, okay? Say okay. All right, you're on recording saying that. Okay, gotcha. Hey guys, y'all have a wonderful and blessed week. Clay, do you have a song for us?
Yeah, stand with me everyone. Let's join together singing hymn 329. There's power in the blood.